first, let's start off with some of the statistics. I didn't do this project by myself. I was working with people from Kreukvrij, which is a motion graphics studio, and it was directed by Olaf Remy. We worked on a creative team with one art director, a motion graphics specialist, and three other CG artists. We were purely focusing on the part of the 3D animation. My part in this team was building the rigs. And what is building rigs? When I'm working with Cinema 4D, I'm not animating anything. I just make sure that objects can be animated by proper animators, because I don't have any feeling for timing. And I wanted to make that as easy as possible. So when I deliver some kind of light, like this one, animators must be able to control this entirely without seeing any extra objects. If you're familiar with the movie Transformers, you probably know that Optimus Prime was built of, let's say, about 10,000 parts, and you can't expect from an animator to go into the hierarchy and find a little pinky of the robot to move that. You need a rig, you need some kind of construction, so an animator can just go with the flow. So, this is, for instance, a light that I created for a different commercial. And what you can see is I'm able to rotate the light. I can rotate all kinds of joints and even move the light with a few goals right here. You can see here I get a light goal, and by just moving that, we can move the light in this direction. The reason it actually had three parts was because it has to be some kind of intimidating light. It was used in an interrogation. And I can show you the final clip, what the animators actually did with it. It's not finished yet, but it will be soon on television.
Hey.
And it's from a program called Alles Kids. And here are the lights, really intimidating the person. Also, the goal was completely constructed in Cinema 4D, as well as the audience. And all those little constructions are coming by. So this commercial was also created together with Kreukvrij. But let's go and focus on the Sky Radio commercial. And you always start with a project preparation. And what we really wanted to do is create some kind of paper craft project. While opening a pop-up book, everything would pop out of the book. So we start always off with a storyboard. And you can see here, we have a book. The book opens, and from that moment on, a house appears. A camera would focus on the house. Page turns and we end up in a supermarket. A couple comes in and the cart is loaded with all kinds of fruits and vegetables and stuff like that. Page turns again, a car appears. And it was a very fun part because we started off with a Porsche, but they want to have a family kind of feel. So the woman drives and it's a different kind of car. Then we had a close-up to the people who were sitting in the car, and those people would be made out of paper. Suddenly, the couple's on the beach, and after that, the page turns, a piggy bank comes up and is filled with coins. And after that, another page turns, a radio would appear, we get a close-up of the radio, and then the commercial would end. I really would like to focus on this particular shot we did for the Sky Radio commercial. And as you can see, we got this paper feel little car running around, and a small family inside. And let's see how we do that. So first, you do a lot of research. So I went on the internet and we did some research about papercraft. And as you can see here, this is a very simple example of papercraft. You start off with a piece of paper, fold it together, and you get some kind of model. And, well, you can probably expect what you get out of this. But people really make an art out of this. It's unbelievable how creative people can be and what they actually built out of just a few sheets of paper. Also, we did a lot of research on the books, the real pop-up books. We actually bought some on Amazon and really got into how did they construct them. How is it possible that when you open a book, something comes out? I apologize for the bad quality of this video. It's really stuck. But it really gives a good impression what is possible when you're creating a pop-up book. So, as you can see, we got some very real music in the back as well. And all kinds of things pop out of the book. So this is what we really had to simulate. Starting off with that, I always start with a basic animation. Just don't go modeling into nowhere and end up with a system that doesn't work. So just start off with a very basic setup so we can actually see what is going on. And immediately we noticed it is very hard to create such an animation without having to use a lot of animation tracks. So we start off, well, quite simple, with a book animation, the page folds open. It's very easy to animate in Cinema 4D. People who are working with After Effects really feel right at home when they open a program. So let's see first, I have the book page right here. Just drag it around a little bit. I see that the pitch of this object should be animated. I control click that, and in frame 50, just pull it down, control click it again, and I already had an animation. When I'm creating very complex objects, I always use the new layer manager. The layer manager was introduced, I believe, in version 11 or 12, and it makes a lot of, well, you can really clean up your scene. Let's say it like that. So the next part is creating cross beams, and these cross beams had to be animated in exactly the same time, at exactly the same time as the folding of the page. So I introduced the cross beams right here, and you can see we had to animate those as well during the folding process. And on top of those, we had some other parts that also had to be animated. Those are those little side panels right here. Fortunately, we could use a symmetry object to animate those, and to make it even more complex, we also had to put some stuff on the top that also had to be opened. So, in a certain way, we can actually animate the entire page. So, if we were looking at the finished result, you end up with something like this. As you can see, it's quite a complex animation, and I can't expect from an animator to animate that all in a few frames. You end up with lots and lots of tracks, and well, it's very hard for them to do. So I had to find a solution to solve this. And the solution comes in a rigging in Expresso solution. Again, Expresso is the scripting language of Cinema 4D, and you can automate some processes. And what I really wanted to accomplish is just one slider to open the entire book. So for most people, Expresso can be quite intimidating. What is actually going on? So for now, I will give you an Expresso 101. Expect the following when you're doing Expresso. I always compare it to communication in a very basic level. You have one can on the right, one can on the left, and the red can is actually telling the blue can what to do. So we got the first one on the left is singing, and the blue one is listening and actually reacting to the information that the red can is putting out. So, if I visualize it in Expresso, you will end up with something like this. Looks very simple. Always a connection from left to right. But the best part is, you can have more listeners than just one. So, I can have objects react on just one single object and do all the same movements. And it will look a bit like this. I'll give you a small example. I'm opening a new scene of a very simple expression. Just turn off the floor so we get a better view of the entire project. Oh, that's not the floor, that's the floor right here. And what I really want to do now is when I'm turning the steering wheel, I want the front wheels to react on that same steering. So I have a controller right here, which is just a null called controller, so I can find it back when I'm opening the project again. Add a expression tag, and for the people who are pretty familiar with Expresso, we did update the entire interface in release 14. So I just drag in my steering wheel, and the steering wheel is now represented as a node, which has an input port and an output port. So the steering wheel is now going to communicate with the wheels and transfer some information. So I go to the right wheel right here, and also the left wheel, and first check in my attributes what kind of attributes I really want to send to the other objects. So, for the steering wheel, I probably need the bank parameter. I always test it right here. Let's see. Yep, the bank parameter is the one I need to push. So, I go to my coordinates and say rotation bank. Then I go to my steering wheels, the right wheel here, and let's see. I probably need a rotation on the heading. Let's put this one back. And yep, it's the heading that actually moves. So what I do right here now is go to the coordinates rotation H, coordinates rotation H, and connect those inputs to the output. And right now I already have a very nice script, and you can see it works. When I go to my steering wheel and turn it right now, you can see, I do have to use the right angle. The bank, here we go. And let's pick the steering wheel, that will help as well. Ooh, that looks very sad, but you get the idea. So, this is a very easy way to control one object with the others. But then there are some problems with that. And I'll show you that in our next example. If you want to use Expresso, there's one note you really should remember. It's called the range mapper, and it will make sure that the following object, the following fault, will not occur. Again, I'm going to not the basic setup. 1 second. Range mapper problems, that's the one. Going to the setup, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to lift the red cube and make the blue cube interact on that. So, again, I just create a null object, call this one controller, add a expression tag, like this, and put in the driver cube, put in the driven cube, go to the output port and say coordinates position Y. So when I'm moving the driver cube up, it will turn the driven cube. So I go to the blue cube, say coordinates rotation H. So what they're going to do now is use the units of the cube moving up to the rotation of the second cube. Let's combine these and link them like this and animate this. So I start off with my driver and make a keyframe. Go to, let's say, frame 65, put it up a little bit and make another keyframe. And what you can see now is that the blue cube is going absolutely insane. When I'm looking at the driven parameters, we already see we have over 30,000 degrees of rotation on the H. And at a certain point, well, she probably won't like it anymore. So let's see how we can solve this problem. What is actually going on? What we're actually trying to do now is convert centimeters into degree. And that's not a very good relation. I always compare it with a household. When you're in a house, you have energy, and energy comes in some kind of forms, like gas, electricity, and water. And what you really can't do is mix electricity with water. You get an espresso 404 instead of a 101, and you probably end up with something like this. If anybody wants to win a t-shirt, who's the artist that created this character? Right, so you end up with something like this. How do we solve this problem? We can have a range mapper. So, end up with the following situation. Going to a robot hand I created. And what if I want to drive this hand? There's also something else. I really dislike the idea of constantly moving up cubes to animate something. What I also want to do is not only using the range mapper, but also have some easy access for my animators. So I'm going to create a HUD or a head-up display so they can easily make the animations. So I start off with a null. Again, call it controller. And what I'm going to do next is add some what we call user data. And user data allows you to create your entirely own custom-made interface. So I add a group of data, place it right here, and call this hand. Then I add my own slider by say add data and call this finger. Choose for a float slider interface, and it just determines how it will look. And the units that's going to use, let's say 0 to 100, because it's very easy to calculate. If you want to have half, it will be 50. That easy. Click OK and I'm done. I have here now my hand parameter. Also here the fingers, but I really want to have it in view, so just go with the right mouse button and say add to HUD, console drag it right here, and say show always, so it will always be visible, and I can just use it in my screen without going into all my objects. Again, I'm going to create a expressor tag, drag in my controller, go to hand, and say finger. Then I'll use all the joints of this hand, just like that. Say coordinates rotation pitch, coordinates rotation pitch, and again coordinates rotation pitch. And if I would connect those nodes now, you'll probably see a finger just going insane and turning and turning and turning and turning, and that's not something I want to accomplish. So what I'm going to do now is introduce this range mapper node. I go into my X-pool, where you can find all the nodes of Expresso, and just type in range mapper, or even range. Pull this in here, and now I can use this some kind of super converter to change the units I used in my slider to units I can actually use for the rotation of the fingers. You can see here right now, okay, we have a value from 0 to 100, and I just convert it to a certain degree, let's say 0 to 30 degree. And with that, I actually constructed an entire own interface to rotate this pinky. So if you take this a little bit further and start doing some more rigging, you'll probably end up with something like this. You can see here, we got the entire hand working. I also did some animation on the thumb. You can also do 2D input. And, oh, I think he really finds it okay. Yep. So, when we go a little bit further in that, I'll show you the rigs we actually used in the Sky Radio commercial. So first, we had this on the first page, we had this house popping up. And as you can see, I only have two sliders for my animators. One is a fold and one is to open the door. And just by dragging this entire slider here, you can see the house pop up. So, now it's gone, and now it's there. And for the rest of the animation, I even made a slider to open the door. If you're looking at the expressions, it looks kind of complex, but if you just read from one side to the other, we got a fold, it goes through a range mapper, and it just rotates stuff. We also have a negate mode, and a negate is a very simple way to invert a certain value. Instead of going from 0 to 30, you go to 0 to minus 30. That's all there is to it. So, let's see another example, which is the car. Just open the file of the car, and you can see, again, I only have one slider, and the entire car folds up. After we did all the rigging, you can finally start modeling. We now finally have a setup that actually works, so let's start off with the modeling part of this animation. For this time, I will focus just on the car. You can see in the storyboard, it was a very nice family car, so we picked a Peugeot 206, which is a very friendly car. People can get bad at it. So you start off with, again, finding reference. And one of the most popular websites to do that is theblueprints.com. You should write it down. They have very accurate blueprints of cars, vehicles, helicopters, human bodies, everything. Some you can even buy in Illustrator format, so you can blow them up any size you like. And another one that's really worth noticing is cgtextures.com, where you can find all kinds of textures. We really needed very high density paper textures. And, well, you can download a few of them free for a day. And if you want to have even bigger sizes, higher resolutions, you can just get bigger ones for not that much of money. So, let's start off with the modeling. When you're going into Cinema 4D, there are quite a few approaches for modeling. For instance, if I have to create a character, I most of the time start off with a box or a object that really already looks like a character. For instance, I really think this looks like an orange. So, this object is still a parametric object. It can be defined by the parameters right here, so I can choose for, let's say, a bookie, or I can use an icosa or dodeca, anything you want. You make this editable, so now I can change it in polygon mode. I go to my polygon mode and just add some eyes or eye sockets. Choose a mouth, make an inner extrude, make an extrude, and I already got some kind of face. Put it inside a hypernerve, and here we go. I already got a little small character. So that's one way to go. Another way of approaching is using splines. And splines are paths that you can actually import from Illustrator if you want to. But also Cinema 4D has very good options to draw your objects. Splines are very usable for any kind of round objects, but also for, let's say, a iPad video. If I want to create an iPad video, I'll just start with a rectangle, make it a little bit thinner. Make sure that the corners are rounded, not that much, just a little bit less. Create another spline for the screen, make it a little bit smaller again, like that. And also create a circle for, what's it called? Touch wheel, something like that. Create a ring out of it, just like that. I make all the splines editable and say objects connect and delete, so I convert this into one spline and put it inside an extrude nerves, and here I have my iPod video. So that easy. The modeling approach that I'm going to use for the car is a little bit different. If I have to make something very exact, I'm using first, of course, a reference right here. And the second thing I'm going to do is I'm always looking at the model, study it, and see what the most round parts of the model are. That's my starting point. I see often people just starting with a cube and trying to get to some round shape, and that's nearly impossible. So always look at the most round part of this car. And as you can see, oh, didn't want to do that. Those are the wheel arches that you can find right here. So I'm going to my left view, introduce a disc, and put this on a right plane. So let's say plus X. And also want to see all the lines, which is very important if you start modeling. I'm going to decrease its size until it's just about here and fits on the wheel arch. Yep, that's about it. I'm going to slice it into half, just like that. Put in some decent degrees. And then, very, very important, I'm going to decrease its amount of segments. If you start off with a lot of segments, it gets nearly impossible to model at a certain point because you have to, well, choose all the points. And we have a very cool tool in Cinema 4D. It's called a hypernerves object to smooth everything out. So my suggestion is less is more. Try to use as less polygons as possible. And if you don't, if you're done with that, put in a hypernerf and it will entirely smooth out. So I increase the inner radius like this. And choose about 12 rotation segments. 12 is more than enough, and I really adore the number 12 because you can separate it or divide it by 1, 2, 3, 4, and 6 without ending up with any kind of, half numbers. So, I make this editable, and for the following, I'm going to use a technique you probably also did when you were a little kid, on vacation with your parents, and you were on the back seat of the car, and they give you this very beautiful book. And it had all these kinds of drawings in it, but you can actually follow points until you get a giraffe just by following the numbers. What I'm going to do is a technique that's quite about the same. I just get my move tool and press Control and just follow the lines I need to have to create this hood, just like that. Move a little bit, a little. Get my bridge tool, and the bridge tool creates polygons between those points. And with this little technique, oh, that's not right. You can see in no time I can create a shape which is very custom and, well, I don't find here in my primitive something like Peugeot Fender. So with that, we got this going on. I go into my perspective mode, perspective view. And we see it right here. Just place it a little bit on the model mode. I just place it a little bit on the left. And what I can do now is put all those points into a Z-axis or in depth. Select them. Go a little bit here. Select these edges right here on the model. Right like this. Get an extrude tool and extrude the edges still here. And you can see it's almost tries to follow the same shape, just place it inside a hyperNURB, and voila, already got the basic shape of the car. So this is a very interesting technique you can use. For the model itself, we also needed to create the paper materials. And when I start off with creating materials, I always start off with a basic setup so I can actually see what the materials are doing. For this, always use a scene that already contains light. Light is very important for the material, so you really should start off with a basic setup with some lights before you start creating your textures and model materials. So, I create a light, and the first light I'm going to create is a key light, and for my key light, I use a area light. And some of you just might want to know, why are you using an area light? It's not very logical. Most of the time we're using for a key light a spotlight. There's a certain parameter in an area light that's not available in the spotlight because a spotlight is a point light. So, what's that? If you want to create some decent materials, you also need reflection. And not only reflection from, let's say, a sky object, but maybe also the reflection of the lights that actually light the object. So what you can do inside a area light is choose for the option show in reflection, and the light will actually be shown inside the material of the object. I always also like to add some atmosphere already in my material scenes. So for this key light, I'll choose a nice yellow color. Don't overreact with these color parameters because it will get very hairy if you create all kinds of hunt for red October like rats and stuff. So just move another copy of this light to the other side. This will be my fill light. Change it to a nice blue color. And for the key light, I'll activate the option shadow. So when I render my scene, I already get an impression how my materials are going to look. Now I start off with creating my materials. So again, I create a material. And the first thing I do is just turn off the specular because I want to have some kind of matte material. I don't want it to be shiny, it's paper. You might want to add a little bit of reflection if you're using a paper like inkjet paper or something that has a very fine layer on it which reflects. And what I'm going to do now is just open here the content browser. And in the content browser you can see we have lots and lots of presets also for my materials. So I can just say I want some paper presets. And you can see here I already got an entire newspaper which is rigged, but also a newspaper page, which is a very nice paper texture. Just drag it in, and it's already here, right on my material. Drag the material on my cube, and let's see what it is doing. Well, that's not looking too bad, but maybe I want to have, let's say, a reddish kind of paper. Do I have to change that in Photoshop? No. I can just introduce a layer right here, and as you can see, we have Photoshop inside Cinema 4D. You can compare this layer with the layers you know from Photoshop in the layer panel. I just add a new color, let's say a shader, color. Choose here for a nice red, dark red color. And change the opacity to a color. And decrease it or increase it, and you can see it immediately has effect. So we already have some kind of red color right now. Also, it's way too perfect. We need some folding in the surface going on. So what I'm going to do next is introduce a bump map. And in the bump map, I'm going to load a noise shader. The noise shader gives you lots and lots of possibilities. It's a shader, so you can make it as large as you want. You can create complete skies out of it if you want to. But you really need to know what kind of noise you are going to use. And when I'm opening this list, I can understand it might be a little bit confusing and maybe even quite intimidating. So, what is all this? Well, I don't know either, but happily we have this little triangle right here, so I can see, hey, this really looks like paper. Maybe this one. So, with this noise, well, I already have a little bit of a bump, and you can see that when I render my scene, the cube is not that perfect anymore. There's all kinds of stuff going on and it's less perfect. So in this way you can create all those kinds of materials and add it to your models. You can also layer your materials. You can animate, of course, your materials. So, for instance, just like any other animation you create, if I go to my color channel right here, create a keyframe and go to my frame 90, just make a different kind of paper and create another keyframe, you will see Cinema 4D interpolates the animation. So we started with something green and end up with something red. So everything is animatable. So, by adding all these textures, we are finally done for rendering. We also, of course, did a lot of lighting, but I left that to the specialists. The next thing I wanted to talk about is how to get this entire project rendered in Cinema 4D to After Effects. There are a few things we had to do. First, we needed a multi-pass rendering because we needed object buffers so we can mask out certain objects of the scene. We needed a depth pass so we can create depth of field effects. And we also needed some kind of motion blur. For this, I'll open another scene. Go to my rendering. And let's start off with something we call multipass. Cinema 4D and After Effects are very, very good friends. We have a very good relationship between those programs, back and also forth. What you can do is you can export any 3D object position to After Effects. That's very easy. Just say I want to have this VW van, and in this VW van I want to attach a particle emitter in After Effects. I just go to my tags, place an external compositing tag, and as you can see, I already now have a null, and I even can place a solid in on that, and the solid will be exported to After Effects. After Effects has a vice versa version. You can actually export your lights and cameras from After Effects via a plugin straight into Cinema 4D, which is very, very nice now with CS6 out, because CS6, of course, knows motion capture, motion tracking, sorry. And you can actually export those motion tracking data from After Effects back to Cinema 4D. This is not the only thing that's possible. Let's say if I want to render this entire scene, but I really want to be able to adjust, let's say, one of those surfboards right here. I just click it. Let's open this VW fan. Go to the small parts and we see the Imperial, and on the Imperial we also have the surfboards or something else. Really doesn't matter. Go to the tags, place a compositing tag, and for the compositing tag I say you belong to object buffer 1, and I can render this object buffer 1 separate to Cinema to After Effects, and it will come out as a separate layer. So, how do you do that? First, you want to determine which light do you want to render as multipass. So you're going to separate that one from the rest. Let's say, for instance, I want this key light to be rendered in three separate layers: a specular layer, an ambient layer, and a shadow layer. I select the light and say here, I want you to be a separate pass. Then I'll go to my render settings, and in my render settings, I go into the option multipass. And here you can see the option separate lights, which is now set on none, which means that every light is contained in just one layer. One layer for the specular, one for the diffusion, and one for the shadows. If I place this on all the lights will be containing, will be converted to separate layers. Which is a very bad idea if you just place a light in a particle emitter and you have about 500 lights, because when you have 500 lights, you have probably 1500 layers. So, in this case, I would say, you know what, just do use the selected lights, and that's what I just activated. Then I'm going to my multipass mode and say, add image layers, and all these layers will be separated from each other. And what you can actually see now is I got an ambient layer, I got a diffusion layer, I got a specular layer, and all those layers are combined in a After Effects file, which I can just open in After Effects. I'll start it up on the background. So the only thing I have to do next is going to the save tab and just say render my multipass image, and very important, create for me a After Effects composition, which I can load into After Effects and adjust. So all the layers will be loaded in one After Effects composition file, and also the overlays, and will be just set perfectly. It will include the 3D data, which is my camera, my lights, my external compositing tags on separate objects. The only thing I have to do next is go to multipass and also add that object buffer I wanted. And another pass, which is very important, I want to have a depth map. And the depth map is black and white information. Objects on the front will be rendered white, objects on the back will be rendered black, and all kind of grayscale variations in between. And I can use that data to create a depth map in depth of field. So, I'm not going to render all this for you because it's not a very fast computer and it'll probably take a while for this scene. So, I already prepared it for you. I'm going to After Effects, double click on the project window, and oh, that's not what I intended. Stop that. Double click and go to the multipass file, go to the AAC file that has been created, open it, and you can actually see we got this v.multipass and all the layers for this project are already blended. Everything is in order. You can see my 3D cam, you can see the lights you can actually use to light other objects inside After Effects. But the best part is, I really hate the shadow. The shadow is way and way too strong. I just open it, go to opacity, and decrease the opacity of the shadow without rendering the entire scene over. Another big advantage, just close this project, is that After Effects has some very cool tools to add motion blur in a very easy way. Now don't get me wrong, I really, really love the new motion blur options we have in release 13 with the new physical render. They are physical correct, they work in transparency, they work in reflection, and I have to do some kind of architectural visualization, I will use the motion blur or the depth of field effect from Cinema 4D. But when you have to create a very fast animation, action-packed for a just a logo animation or something like that, I often use something different. It's a plugin, which you can find from Revision, and it's called Real Smart Motion Blur. I made this lovely animation of the V-Dub actually hitting over some boxes, and I need some motion blur in here. Just select the layer and say, well, add some motion blur right now, and up, it's there. So we got some decent motion blur. I can increase or decrease the intensity without rendering over and over and over. So this is a very good way to add some motion blur to your scenes. Well, with all this going on, we finally came to the final result, and it's right here.
Heel, heel binnenkort. Heel, heel binnenkort. Een jaar lang gratis leven. Sky Radio betaalt je huur. Sky Radio betaalt je huur of hypotheek. Je mag gratis shoppen. We betalen je benzine. En zelfs je vakantie. En het verhaal is nog mooier. Alles wat we voor jou betalen. Schenken we ook aan. Dus luister naar Sky. Dus luister naar Sky en win een jaar lang gratis leven.
And it's gone. So, if there are any questions about this project, about any features I've shown in Cinema 4D, please come by in the booth. I'm happy to answer your questions. And also, if you're interested in Cinema 4D, there are a lot of demo dev days available over there. Please ask for a demo dev a day. Let your badge be scanned so we can inform you about upcoming fairs and upcoming updates. And I really want to thank you for your attention. Thank you.